Well, Father, this morning, just like any other morning, we don't just need to hear some words from a human being up here or just songs that people sing. We need to hear from you. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, that your spirit is in this place. And thank you for such a simple song that was just sung, and yet it's so timely right now. And I just pray for everyone in this room that we could be attentive to what you have to say through your word. Help us to learn something today that's really going to enable us to know what it means really to live a victorious life, no matter what we're facing. Just like that song said, times when we don't understand, things happen that we cannot comprehend. That does not mean you're not in control and that you don't love us and that you're not still working your plan in our life. And I thank you, I give you praise for the truth of that statement. So I pray you speak to us today, Lord Jesus, and give hope to us. And Lord, we ask this in your name. Amen. All right, if you'll open your Bibles to Acts chapter 25, we're looking at chapter 25 and chapter 26, and I want to talk today about not just surviving, but thriving. You know, we all are impressed when we see people perform feats that we just cannot explain. If I see someone walk on a high wire with no net below them, then I'm pretty impressed with that. I see these gymnasts, and they do feats that I just can't imagine. Well, they do the Iron Cross, and they just hold themselves up like this, and then they can push up in a push-up position all in air. And they're just doing this with their arm strength. I mean, it's phenomenal when you see that. When you see great feats that people have accomplished, certainly that's stunning. You think that's amazing. But I'm telling you, one of the most amazing things that I see in life is when I see people who they go through extremely difficult times, and yet they're not just barely getting by, they actually thrive in those times. And that's what's on display in these verses of Scripture from Acts chapter 21 to Acts chapter 26. The Apostle Paul, I look at him, I just have a whole new respect for Paul and the way that he's dealing with this. Because he is not a man, with all that he's going through here, he is not just surviving, he is thriving in his life. Let's just think for a little bit about Paul's situation. And just by way of reminder, very briefly, when you come to Acts chapter 25 and 26, now he's going to be called upon for the fourth time to give a defense of himself when the man has done nothing wrong. He has not committed any crime, not hurt anyone, and yet he's having to stand before political figures and give a defense of himself. You remember in Acts 21, he was in the place of worship, and he was just worshiping privately to himself. Some Jews came that were antagonistic toward him. They made up stories. They told lies about him. They stirred up the crowd. The crowd becomes so incensed, they start beating this man. It's just like if someone pulled you out of the service today and started beating you and for no reason. You hadn't done anything. And that's what they were doing to him. It got so bad, they wanted to kill him. The commander has to come and rescue him. And when he does rescue him, Paul asks to speak to the crowd. And so there's his first defense before this unruly crowd. And they listen at first until he makes the statement that Jesus told him, I want you to go to the Gentiles. And when he said Gentile, then the people said, he's not fit to live. Let's kill him. Well, after that, he then stands before the Sanhedrin. And that's not a pleasant experience. Because the high priest, Paul makes one statement, and the high priest said, strike him in the mouth. And the word strike means a violent blow. He said, hit him. And Paul had done nothing. So Paul, surveying the situation, realizing he was in danger, he saw there were Pharisees and Sadducees in the room. So he just said, well, I believe in the resurrection. That got the Pharisees to side with him. But again, there's turmoil in there. The commander has to rescue him again. Well, there's a plot to end his life. And so with that plot, then the commander, word gets to the commander. The commander takes Paul to Caesarea, where he's under Felix. And now Jews come. Ananias, his high priest, comes. He brings his lawyer, Tertullus. Tertullus, this gifted orator, is going to be the speaker and bring all these charges against Paul. And he does. And that's the third time. And now here in Acts chapter 25, 26, the Apostle Paul's going to have to stand before King Agrippa and Bernice and Festus, a new governor who took over. And so for the fourth time, don't you know this would get a little bit exasperating? I've done absolutely nothing wrong, and yet I'm having to defend myself on these four different occasions. So he had that going on. And then when you stop and think about this, these people who were against him, they didn't just want him to pay some monetary fine. They didn't want him to just serve some time in prison and then be released. They wanted him dead. Now, in my lifetime, I have never had anyone say to me, "We want to kill you. We're planning on killing you." And I doubt any in this room, I don't know, maybe someone in the room has had that kind of threat hanging over their head. Men and women who've been in war, that's a different situation. Certainly they're under the threat of death. But I'm just talking about living your life every single day. I don't know that any of us have lived with that kind of pressure upon our lives, but here's the Apostle Paul, and he has many people. The high priest, this attorney, all these Jewish people, they wanted him dead. And there were some who had committed themselves to assassinating him. And Paul knew about all this. And to live with that kind of stress, that would just take the life out of it. And then these people that he had to stand before. These people were so corrupt in their lives. First of all, they were liars. They were lying. Everything they said against him was a lie. It was not true. I heard the other day a person making a statement about our society right now, and they said this is a factless society. Factless. In other words, you could just stand up and say whatever you want to say with no fact to back it up. In fact, knowing full well it's a bold-faced lie what you're saying, but you just go right ahead and say it, and we'll report it as fact when it is not. And you can see that in the religious world, you see it in the political world, you see it in the news media, you see it in the educational world. You can see it in any facet of life. And here's the Apostle Paul having to deal with these people so corrupt they lie consistently against him. But then just the caliber of people that they were. Now, I told you about Annas, the high priest, Ananias, and I told you about Tertullus, the lawyer, last week, and this man that he had to stand before, Felix, and Drusilla, his wife. But now you come over to Acts 25 and 26, now you get to stand before Festus. And I will say this about Festus. Festus was a whole lot better governor than Felix. He took over from Felix. But then there's also King Agrippa and Bernice. And King Agrippa and Bernice, they were just something else. You know, when you read here in Acts chapter 25, you can read that Festus, he consulted with Agrippa. And then it says in verse 23, the next day Agrippa and Bernice came with great pomp and entered the audience room with the high-ranking officers and the leading men of the city. And at the command of Festus, Paul is brought in. I hear all these so-called dignitaries, and King Agrippa and Bernice are brought in with all this pomp and all this ceremony. You think, well, these are dignified people, upstanding people. What do you think of when you read King Agrippa and Bernice? You think that's husband and wife? Well, I'll be honest with you, the first time I read this, that's what I thought. And it was only when I started studying this in the years past that I began to realize this is not a husband and wife. King Agrippa and Bernice were brother and sister. They were the brother and sister of Drusilla, Felix's wife, that woman you've already learned about. Their father was this King Agrippa I. But here's another little tidbit you need to know about them. King Agrippa and Bernice were living in incest. Brother and sister, and they were having sexual relations with each other. And this woman, this Bernice had no moral scruples, not in the least. Because at one time, the Emperor Vespasian, she was his mistress. And then after that, she was the mistress for his son, Titus. But she always went back to her brother. And this was known all over Rome. And so all these people that walk in with this pomp and ceremony, and you think they're so dignified, these people are corrupt. It's unbelievable, the depravity in their lives and the way that they were living. And here's Paul. This is who he gets to stand before. And then there was one other thing that I would just share about all this. It would add to some burden. This didn't take place in a two-week period of time or two-month period of time. Look what it says in Acts chapter 24 and verse 27. It says, when 2 years had passed, Paul stood before Felix, 2 years passed, and he is succeeded by Festus. And Felix, because he wanted to grant favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison. So 2 years go by. So with all that going on, don't you understand how the Apostle Paul could just be at his wit's end and think, Jesus, I thought you told me that you were standing by me and that I was going to be able to speak for you in Rome, and yet here I sit, and 6 months go by, a year goes by, a year and a half goes by, I've got all these people that want to kill me, I've got all these people lying against me, and the ones that I have to stand before and defend myself are completely corrupt. Can't you see how the guy would just give up, want to throw his hands up in the air, be so discouraged or depressed in his life, and yet stunningly, the Apostle Paul is not just surviving, he's not just barely hanging on here. This man is thriving in his living in the midst of all of this. You know, it says, hold your place here in Acts for a moment. Look at these verses over in Isaiah chapter 40, and they're popular verses. But let's remind ourselves of what this says, Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 28 and following. And it says this, do you not know, have you not heard, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary. He increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. And I just want to raise the question when you read those verses, I mean, is that realistic? I mean, is that real life? Can that truly happen to you? Well, we see it on display in the life of the Apostle Paul here, and I'm saying it can happen to you. You know, more likely than not, I know for certain. I've talked to a family this week. They have a loved one right at the point of death. I know of other crises that's going on in the lives of people right here. And you wonder, is that true? Does that apply to me? Yes. You can be thriving in your life. And when I say that, I don't mean you're bouncing off the wall with a smile on your face. You know, I get tired sometimes hearing people, they think that's a victorious life. They've got to put on the show where they smile and, hey, everything's great. I've lost my job. All my money's gone, but I've never felt better. No, that's ridiculous. That's not what it's talking about. That's not being true to what you really are inside. I'm talking about in the times of our grief, in the times when we're challenged, when we lose, even in those times, when people are lying against you, when people betray you, that you can still have a calm and a confidence in your life and a peace in your life that people just cannot explain. You can't even explain it. That kind of victory in your living. Can you experience that? Absolutely, you can. I went to the evangelism conference this week, and on Tuesday they had some conferences you could attend, breakout sessions, and I went to a couple of them, and the first one I went to was about lay renewal, and I hope we can have this sometime here in our church, but it's just interesting to hear laymen lead it, and there's a part during this time where they break up in groups, and one of the pastors who had this said he was in the group, and there were a lot of men in the group. And the question was this, when's the time in your life where you felt closest to Jesus? Well, there was just silence. And all of a sudden, one guy who never spoke up, the pastor said this guy, he just didn't want to talk in front of people. But in that setting, he did. And he said this. He said, it was when my wife of many years walked out on me. He said, in that time, I felt closest to Jesus. The pastor said, when that guy finished, another man spoke up, said the same thing. Then a third man spoke up, said the exact same thing. The pastor said, these men were all in my church. But they'd come after all this had happened. He said, I didn't know this had gone on in their lives. And they said, that's when we were closest to Christ. He helped us in those kinds of times. Here's the Apostle Paul going through all this. And here's this man still victorious in his living. Well, that brings us to the question, how can we experience this kind of life? I mean, truly, and I would say this, sometimes whenever things are going your way, you're not experiencing this life. How do you experience this life of victory that the Christian faith talks about? Well, I believe it's summed up. I want you to turn to Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18. Just one verse the Apostle Paul gives, what he's challenging the believers to do. Ephesians 5 and verse 18. And he says this. He says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. He said, instead, here's what you need to do. Be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Just simple words. Be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. I'm telling you, that was what was happening in the life of the Apostle Paul. Next week, I'll give you evidences of this. But that's how he's able to live in the midst of all that he has to face in his life. He practiced exactly what he's preaching here in this passage of Scripture to these believers. But listen, that'll work for you. I'll tell you, there's nobody in this room. I don't even know everybody in this room, but I know this. There's nobody here that wants to just hang on. I'm just barely hanging on. It's all I can do to get out of bed in the morning. Nobody wants to live like that. You want to be excited about life. You want to have a purpose in life. Well, that can happen to you, but the one thing that's necessary is this. A person has to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, I want you to think about what the filling of the Spirit is not, because so many people, there are different words that the Bible will use that people, sometimes they get confused. They think they're all the same thing, and they're not. For example, the filling of the Spirit is not the indwelling of the Spirit. It's not that. The indwelling of the Spirit, that's talking about the Holy Spirit of God coming to live in a believer's life. And the Spirit of God lives in every believer's life. Boys and girls in this service, teenagers, adults, anybody who's accepted Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God lives in your life. He indwells you. But just because you're indwelt by the Holy Spirit does not mean you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, let me give you an example. Look over in Hebrews. Hold your place there a second. Look over in Hebrews, the fifth chapter. And look how the writer of Hebrews speaks to these people that he's addressing. Hebrews chapter 5. In verse 11, he says this. He has just given them some very profound spiritual thoughts. But he says this, verse 11, we have much to say about this, but it's hard to explain because you're slow to learn. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you in the elementary truths of God's Word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. But he says, here you are. By this time, you should be mature. You should be teaching, but you're not. You're still just a babe. We just have to spoon feed you. We just have to give you milk. Now, I tell you, all those people he was addressing, they all had the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of God. The Spirit of God lived in them. But they were not filled with the Spirit. Let me just read these verses to you real quick from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. The Apostle Paul says this very thing to the believers at Corinth. He said, brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You're still worldly. For since there's jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, aren't you just mere men? I mean, Paul was exasperated with this. Are you kidding me? Some of you are going around saying, well, I'm following Paul or I'm following Apollos, putting them on the same level with Jesus Christ. Paul says, you're just babies. Now, every one of those that he was writing to, those that he classified as babe, they had the indwelling of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit of God lived in every one of them. But the Holy Spirit of God didn't fill them. The indwelling is not the filling. Here's something else. The baptism of the Spirit is not the filling of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians in chapter 12, verses 12 and 13, he talks about the filling of the baptism of the Spirit. And here's what he says. He says, the body is a unit, though it is made up of many parts, and though all its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slave or free, we were all given the one Spirit to drink. But we're all baptized into this body. Well, that's what the baptism of the Holy Spirit is. At conversion, the Spirit of God incorporates that person into the family of God, to the body of Christ. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. And that takes place the moment you give Jesus as your Savior. The Holy Spirit comes to live within you. You're indwelt by the Spirit. The Spirit of God incorporates in you into the family of God. And that's automatic. You do not have to seek either of those. You don't get Jesus and then seek the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. He comes in. So you trust in Jesus. That's how Jesus comes into your life. You don't have to seek the baptism of the Spirit. It takes place immediately. And I would just venture to say this, I bet you over 99% of believers don't even know that's happening when they're converted. And I just ask you, I don't want any response here, but when you gave your life to Jesus Christ, did you know in that moment that the Holy Spirit of God came to live in your life and that you were baptized into the family of God? Did you know it? I didn't. I was a 7-year-old boy. I had no clue. All I knew was that I was saying yes to Jesus Christ and receiving Him. But when I did that as a 7-year-old child, the Spirit of God came to live in my life and He incorporated me into the family of God, even though I did not know that that happened. But those things, that's not the filling of the Spirit. Well, if it's not, then what is the filling? Well, this is talking about, look back over here in Ephesians, this is talking about the Holy Spirit of God controlling your life. And I'm glad he uses this illustration like he does when he says in this passage in verse 18, do not get drunk with wine. If you're drunk, who's controlling you? Well, the intoxicating substance. That's what's controlling your life. You become drunk. And you're not in charge. That which you're intoxicated with controls you. He said, don't let that happen. Don't be drunk. Don't let some intoxicating substance control your life. He said, you need to be filled, meaning you need to be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. You let Him control you. And look, this is something we must seek. Baptism of Spirit, you don't have to seek. Indwelling of the Spirit, don't have to seek that. But the filling of the Spirit, you have to seek that. Notice he says in this passage, Ephesians 5:18, if you look at it, he says to them, be filled. You be filled. There's something you must do. You must seek the Holy Spirit to control your life. You must pursue Him on this. You say, well, how do I come under the control of the Holy Spirit? Well, you do this through confession of sin. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So there must be confession. I can't harbor sin in my life and be under the control of the Holy Spirit of God. The sin will be controlling me. There must be the confession of sin. And then there is the yielding of your life to the Spirit of God. And you need to do that every day, sometimes many times through the day. Just say, Spirit of God who lives in me, control me. Things are not, my thoughts aren't what they should be. You control me. Help me in this moment. You don't have to say that out loud. You could be in a meeting and be breathing that prayer in your spirit, in your heart to the Lord. But I'll tell you, it's good to begin every day. This will be so wise. I challenge you to do this week. Before you get out of bed in the morning, when you wake up, why not just try this? Just do this. Lord Jesus, I want to thank you for letting me live through the night. You say, well, I don't have to thank him for that. That's given. Really? You think that's automatic? I think that's a beautiful prayer to pray. Thank you for letting me live through the night. So, well, I'm just a student. Thank him for letting you live through the evening. And then just say to him, Lord Jesus, you know what this day holds. I want you right at the beginning of the day to take charge of my life. Control me this day. I'd urge you to just try that this week. Look what it says over here in Psalm 5. I was reading this in devotionals this week, and it really just spoke to me. Psalm 5, verses 1 through 3. The psalmist makes these comments. Psalm 5, beginning in verse 1. Give ear to my words, O Lord, and consider my sighing. Listen to my cry for help, my King and my God, for to you I pray. So he's going through some challenging times. Look at this next verse. In the morning, O Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my requests before you and wait in expectation. But in the morning, I'm not going to live through the day and never talk to Jesus. Do it first thing. Soon as you wake up, before you get out of bed in the morning, I'm going to lay my requests before you. I want to put my life before you and live with anticipation that you can help me be what I should be today. But that's how you yield to the Holy Spirit of God. Listen, when you think of this, in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23, he talks about the fruit of the Spirit, what the Holy Spirit produces in us. And it says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, kindness, goodness. And then here's the statement, self-control. And some people read that and they think, okay, I got to control myself. Self-control. That's part of the Christian life. I've got to control myself. That is not what that's saying. It talks about self-control being the fruit of the Spirit, which means simply this. It's not you controlling yourself. You allow the Spirit of God to control you. He does the self-control. Do you understand this? You cannot control your life. Do you know that? Do you think for one second you can tame all your lust? You think you can? I'm not just talking to guys. I'm talking about women in here. You think you can tame your lust? You can't. You think you can conquer your fears? Overcome all your anxiety? I can do this. I'll just talk to myself enough where I can do this. You think you can make your speech be what it should be? You think you can harness all your thoughts? You cannot. Look what it says in James chapter 3. James just gives one illustration about one part of our body. But in James chapter 3, here's what James says. In verse 2, he says, we all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. But he said, there's nobody like that. We all stumble in many ways. But then he uses these illustrations. He said, when we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Some of you have ridden horses. You put a bridle on that horse, well, you can control where that animal goes. He says, although they're these animals, we can do that. Or he says in verse 4, take ships as an example. Although they're so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. He says, likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person and sets the whole course of his life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. Now look at this next statement. All kinds of animals, birds and reptiles and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man. Isn't that something? You can go to the circus, they can tame lions, they can tame elephants, they can tame all sorts of animals. But he goes on to say this, nobody can tame the tongue. No man can tame his tongue. No woman can tame hers. It's a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. You ever find yourself doing that? Coming to a service like this? Oh God, I just praise you. I love you. Get out of here, see somebody this afternoon that caused you a problem and you're cursing under your breath toward them? He says that goes on. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. He said, my brothers, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. He said it shouldn't be this way, but it is, because man cannot control his tongue. Listen, man can't control his tongue. He can't control his thoughts. He can't control his lust. He can't control his fears. You can't do that. But there's somebody that can, and that's the Holy Spirit of God. And when he talks about being filled with the Holy Spirit, he's saying this is why this is so important. Part of the work of the Spirit is self-control. He's the only one that can control you. So listen, that's why I look at Paul here. Why is the Apostle Paul able to deal with all these corrupt people for this lengthy period of time? They're spewing lies against him. They want him dead, and yet this man's living with victory in his life. How in the world can he do that? Because for one reason, he is filled with the Holy Spirit of God. So look, in closing this message, I just ask you this. Who controls you? Who controls you? You? You trying to do this? That's wasted effort. Or is it the Spirit of God? Let's bow for prayer. Father, this may be one of the most important messages that we hear. Help us, I pray, if there's people in here that have pride in their heart, thinking they can handle things in life. I can make myself be the kind of person I need to be. I can deal with any situation that comes. Break their hearts, Lord, and let them know that's absolutely not true. And Lord Jesus, help them to see just how, for all of us, help all of us to see how desperate we are just to let your Spirit have control of our life. And Father, help us to know this is a day-by-day surrendering that we make. It's not a one-time surrender. We surrender one time to receive Jesus as Savior, and he comes in, and that's forever settled. But Lord, to be filled with the Spirit, that's every day. Every day. So Father, I pray for every believer in this room who this is an issue for right now. I pray that you'd work in their hearts and just help them to know how vital it is that they begin the day with you and live through the day with you, surrendering to you. And Jesus, I pray for people in this room that have never personally met you. What I've been saying today may sound totally foreign to them. But Lord, help them to know this. The Lord Jesus, they're like all human beings. They're sinful. And that sin separates them from God. And Jesus, you loved us enough, and you loved them enough, to come and die on a cross, bearing the burden of their sin and the punishment for their sin. And you conquered death so that they could have forgiveness. And you're the only one who can give that to them. And Lord, if they just know that, that's enough for them to be saved. So I pray for any who have not trusted in you. I pray with your Spirit that you'd work in their heart and help them to trust in you. Lord, you just have your will and your way right now. And I ask this in your name. And while our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, we'll be dismissed. We're going to have a song. But the service is not over, not by any stretch of the imagination. Any commitment. You know, there were some people that came down here a moment ago. There's a meaningful prayer time. Well, this can be a time for you, a time of decision for you. If you've never accepted Jesus, you make your way down here. And we'd be glad to talk with you and tell you how you can make that wonderful decision. As a believer, maybe just where you are, You just need to say, Jesus, I haven't been letting you control me. I've been trying to direct my own life, handle things myself. And I see from Paul's life, I need you. Spirit of God, I need you to control me. Maybe you just need to say that prayer. If you do, I hope you will. It might be you're a believer already and you accepted Jesus, you've never been baptized, and you'd like to be. If that's true, I hope you'd come forward and express that. Or maybe you're looking for a church home, a place where you can serve Christ. And if that's true and you feel like the Lord wants you here, we'd invite you to come forward as well. There'll be people down here to help you. God bless you in any decision you need to make for Christ. I thank you for being here today. We're going to have this song. You do as Christ leads you. And then we'll see you this afternoon at 4 o'clock.